Tara is not feeling well.
I ate them.
Hello and welcome, and god damn it.
Hey, what's up everybody? How's it going? Welcome to Hyper RPG. Hope you enjoy the show. I was going to do a bunch of announcements. The biggest announcement though is that after this, the season 2 premiere of DFA, and the Marauders are back, and it's really exciting. Giant mechs punching each other and drilling into them and blowing them up and shit. Pretty cool.
Sounds pretty amazing.
I'm out of here. Okay, I'm sorry.
That's it?
Well, you know, and every 5 subscribers, there's like a chaos die and a rift tears open in the universe, and these guys gotta deal with all that shit. It's really cool and it's fun. Thank you guys for tuning in to Open Legend RPG.
Bronze
it's really
boys.
Exciting. And obviously, we need to fix the alerts crew on the back end. The alerts have not been shut off yet. See, you know, I'm going to go take care of that stuff. You got it.
All right. And it's also Free Key Friday. So Every single sub, we give away a free steam key. And with that awkwardness out of the way, hello and welcome to Open Legend. You are watching Hyper RPG, a hyperactive, interactive, community-driven channel with RPGs all week long. I think I nailed it right there. Stuck the landing.
50 hours a week, 5 days.
50 hours a week. I actually didn't know that statistic.
Yeah, 50 hours a fucking
50
week.
Hours a week of RPGs here at Hyper RPG. That's pretty amazing. And I am your GM for the RPG today, which is Open Legend. I'm that bronze girl. I am a variety caster here on Twitch, as well as a host here at Hyper RPG. I'm a little bit of a comic book aficionado. But I'm also apparently a roleplay aficionado. And I'm joined today by a super awesome cast of I called them the roleplay Avengers before. I'm gonna use that terminology again, even though Bear's gonna argue with me, but we've just decided he's the Hawkeye of the group.
Just the worst character.
Why don't we start with that? I know Jesse's still getting settled, but why don't we go around and why don't you guys introduce your characters and where you think you were when you started and where you think you are in the campaign. Go ahead, Bear, you go first.
My name is Bear. I'm playing
was brought out on this very adventure with his pals, and now is finding it a lot more difficult to woo the women, and also finds it a lot more difficult to find any women, but that's the role we found ourselves in.
Do you think Jonathan has any regrets coming out into the wilds like this?
Jonathan never has any regrets, but he has made some mistakes.
Good answer. my name is Ivan Van Norman. I am playing Giles Fortinswith. He is a Viscount. He is a bored dandy who decided to come out in the midst of the wild mostly because of his lovely affinity for cartography. He is essentially useless in almost every slighted matter except for the fact that he's quite good with his brain and terrible with his blunderbuss. He also seems to be constantly talking himself into an even worse situation than we were in.
That happened a lot last week.
That happened a lot. He keeps opening his mouth and people don't like what he's saying, but that's fine because Giles is very much a Schlechtenberg elite, and unfortunately he's a very kind-hearted man, but he's not used to being talked to in different ways. Different being people don't like him ways. and that's me. I am Giles Fortinswith.
All right. Steven, do you want to keep yours a secret for the show, or do you want to give us a little bit of an overview? It's completely up to you since you're our special guest for today.
I'm Brom. Schlechtenberg. Too much complexity. Out here in the frontier, things are simple. Me, my sword, and silence.
It won't be much silence for much longer.
You
may have escaped in the hustle and bustle of Schlechtenberg, but unfortunately we are very talkative bunch, and you will probably be getting used to Jonathan and I's banter very quickly.
Yes, you are a talkative bunch. Last week was difficult because it seems like you guys are so used to talking yourselves out of situations. You got yourselves into a little bit of a pickle and you couldn't do that.
Yeah. Although I have to...
Just a little bit.
I have to admit, I'm currently entranced by Nivea, who is this Nymenillian Sylvan who took my tea set, and I'm taking quite a liking to her.
Ooh, really?
Yeah, she's fascinating and wonderful. Look at this interesting creature who likes to pick things up like she's a raven amidst a field.
Yes, yes.
I hate to interrupt. Mm-hmm. I have a quick update on Mr. Chance. Mm-hmm. He's stuck on the 101.
Oh no.
So he'll be joining us the minute he walks into his
abode.
Dwelling. Update.
Well, now we know.
All right.
I guess I will use this time to then instead get our audience caught up with where we are in the story in case you haven't been following along. So our adventurers, since leaving the safety of the sprawling steampunk metropolis of Schlechtenberg, have found themselves in the wild outlands that is Amaurea Dawn. Here they left, once again, the kind of safety of Mundu Watch. It's still pretty much a wild frontier. Under the sort of instruction of a very inquisitive and persuasive young mage named Dahlia, who's led them on a little bit of a wild goose hunt for a relic that she's been wanting to study on behalf of the Mages Society or the Mages Guild of Schlechtenberg. They chased rumors of this relic into the very, very dangerous swamps of a more hostile elf faction called the Valurian. Here they encountered all kinds of things, including other than acidic swamps and carnivorous plants, but also Treant-esque characters and elves called Arbormancers that somehow are able to bend living vines and just the earth beneath them to their will. Scary, scary. They were captured at a camp where they made friends with a roguish character, who will be joining us shortly, who managed to help them escape this camp. And through a series of strange events, they have found themselves at a strange city. City is a relative term, I should say town, coastal town, called Woe's Herald. And here they have sort of found or stumbled upon a very strange Nivelnellian creature named Nanki, who is a collector of sorts, and her companion, Dr. Tavark, who is a person of Schlechtenberg descent, much like our heroes. Where we last left them, Nivhe was getting some medical attention from Dr. Tavark, and our adventurers were catching up with him and sort of becoming more aware of the situation that was going on in the town at the time. Because as Dr. Tavark let our adventurers know, there's been some strange disappearances in this tiny little harbor town. People have gone missing, and there's this weird epidemic where people are sort of starting to get strange skin conditions and deformities, seemingly out of the blue, and they're not sure how it's spreading or what's going on. And so we are there now. I guess I'm trying to think if we should wait a couple of minutes for Jesse, if we should carry on without him. Production crew, please advise.
I personally, in the midst of waiting for Zach to advise, I would like to celebrate the fact that we've managed to survive two chaos portals.
Oh, without, yes. We've survived
without too much worse for wear. In fact, one of the chaos portals led me to getting a mating pair of gremlins, which hopefully will increase the Fulton's with wealth by 3 or 4-fold.
As that now we can... was so... Like, you could have had him as a companion, but as true Schlechtenbergians, you decided to put him in captivity and forcibly breed him for more.
Yep, that's the way Schlechtenbergs do it.
Why see a companion when you can see immediate profit? I don't know what you're thinking.
I would like to say that as someone who's worked with Jesse as a producer before, it's best to just start the show. He'll arrive when he arrives.
Okay, perfect. All right, let's do this. So... we open on the small and almost humble quarters of Dr. Tavark and Nanki. It's clear they've been living here for some time. Their home is made out of coral, like a lot of the buildings in this strange town, but it does have all of the the nice modern comforts of a Schlechtenberg home, given that Dr. Dvorak is very well educated and, you know, is a little bit cultured. And as you walk through his quarters, or his home rather, you realize that there's a lot of little rooms and little offshoots in the back where sometimes he's been taking care of random villagers, and it's almost been doubling as a small hospital of sorts, a small rudimentary hospital of sorts. And you've just spent the night in his home, had a wonderful dinner, and now Dr. Dvorak has laid out a wonderful breakfast spread for you. Nanki has polished the silver to a almost blinding shine.
Yes!
And, you know, Dr. Dvorak is now preparing some tea, as well as crumpets and toast with jam.
Yes.
And things of that nature. He welcomes you to his table now that he sees that you are all awake.
Thank you, Dr. Dvorak, for this wonderful plate that you would give us in the midst of this quite wild frontier. Oh, look, there's a Jesse Cox. And Chance Bordeaux finally joins us. Excellent. Dr. Dvorak, if we're going to help you with this little outbreak that you've been contending yourself with, do you happen to have any patients who are currently in condition that we might interview?
Ah, yeah, I do, but I'm not quite sure that you should interview them, considering we don't know how this spreads, but
are they mad? Are they aggressive?
Huh?
Are they mad? Are they aggressive? Do they strike out?
No, nothing of that nature. We're just not sure how this disease spreads.
Yes, well then you've examined them yourself though, Dr. Dvorak, am I correct? Have you found yourself with symptom?
Not yet. But there are other cases where someone has been in contact with them for a little under an hour and has started showing symptoms.
Hmm.
So we have to be very careful.
But you say the symptoms occur only when they've disappeared for a while and then returned.
Yes, yes. But it seems that, well, how should I put this?
If we're going to be helping one each other, I think it is best to be as transparent as possible, Dr. Dvorak.
I don't know if you noticed, but one of your party is not here.
Oh my. Oh yes, where is Dahlia? Not Dot Dahlia, where is Nim?
Well, it just so happens that, she...
Oh my. Oh, really? Really that quickly? Jeez, we've not been in any contact with anyone.
Well, it may have been the wound on her arm or something, but during the night, she may or may not have grown flippers.
Oh, I
Jonathan
see.
Has just been stuffing his face with breakfast items at this point, but his ears perk upon hearing that and begins to pay closer attention to the conversation.
Flippers.
Yes.
Oh, how
as
delightful.
In webbed appendages?
How monstrous are they? Are they simple webbed appendages, or have they grown in Lurth? Please, Dr. Dvorak, don't spare us without details.
Well, now that you mention it, I have studied them at length, and it's almost like a thin membrane. It's just sort of started to develop between her fingers. Originally, when I examined the wound she had obtained from the strange creature you described, it didn't seem out of the normal or out of the ordinary to me, but after seeing these sudden sort of symptoms exhibit themselves, I can't be sure anymore.
Now, webbed feet overnight is definitely a unique appendage that should be seen with great detail. The question is, of course, that how one discovered these webbed feet if she was in the midst of the night. Did she spark upon them herself, or was this something you observed in tending her wounds?
Well, Nanki may or may not have been in her room.
Oh.
For who knows what purpose, really.
I do so love your little Nanki friend.
But she made a bit of a ruckus in there, and there was a bit of a scuffle and a tuffle, and I went in to stop it all, and that was when I noticed it. Your friend was awfully embarrassed, and I promised her I would do my best to try to mend her to the best of my ability, but she has refused to leave her quarters until then, which honestly may be for the best since we don't know how this strange fish disease spreads.
So you're saying that a lot of the symptoms have a bit to do with different Episcopalian kind of attributes, then. You're seeing the scales, you're seeing webbed feet, you're seeing appendages reduced. It would appear that our, this matter has escalated a bit, and now we are not just doing this for the sake of Woe's Herald, but none for our friend as well. What do you say, Jonathan?
Ah, well, yes. Certainly seems that way. He's just completely transfixed on the idea of Nim with webbed feet right now. There's like nothing else is entering his brain. He's just like wondering what is happening.
Ah, yes, it is a bit strange. Chance, you are quite a late riser. How are you? Please sit down. Have a cup of tea. Have a scrumpet.
Chance is in the doorway, signing remaining copies of one of his books for rabid fans who are outside. walks in. He's like, ah, so we had troubles last night with our lady friend?
Yes, it would appear, Chance, if you are still with us, that Miss Nim has come under illness, apparently with the ongoing mysterious disease that seems to be plaguing Woe's Herald at the moment.
She's got webbed feet.
Thank you, Jonathan.
But, I was. Well, that's. I wouldn't have put it so blunt. She is quite embarrassed about it, you know.
Well, there's nothing to be embarrassed about. You know, I would start to getting more worried if she starts growing gills, but then that could be useful as well. So, Chance, do you know anything about this little issue? I would say it's greater than an issue. Let's call it an outbreak.
You don't think I had anything to do with this, do you?
A chance. One cannot assume one with fame such as you would have to do with anything. However, that being said, do you know anything more than what Mommy Dr. Tavarek doesn't have?
This is all news to me. Look, this town's great. I've been here a few times, but webbed feet? That's new. That's new.
Yeah, well, I see. Well, it would be difficult to investigate this disease unless we had a starting point. Do you suggest something, Dr. Tavarek?
I actually have a great idea. I sent for her last night. She is a little bit. She's a little bit of a.
Jolly Roger.
She can be. Well, she's just. Let's just shake. She can be a little bit of a. And then at this moment, his main door to house is kicked open, and in walks a woman with long flowing black hair, and a giant sniper rifle strapped to her back.
What?
And she is clad in all leather with all kinds of strange sort of machines and augments all over her body. And she walks in like she owns the place. And you quickly realize from the sort of bling on her uniform that she is actually a Schlechtenberg general.
What? Is Woe's Herald just a circus sideshow at this point? General, excuse me. Pardons. What do we owe the pleasure?
Yes, I'm General Lee. Dr. Tavarek sent for me.
That would be apparent. Are you informed of this current outbreak that is laying?
No.
No.
I haven't the slightest idea what's going on. I was just sent for by Dr. Tavarek to potentially lead you in the right direction.
Ah, and that direction would be?
Towards the coast.
I see. As you can see, I am part of the... Sorry.
Oh, yes. As you can see, I'm part of the Schlechtenberg military. Yes. Currently, I am, however, off duty. I came out here when Dr. Tavarek sent for me, since we're pretty close friends, to help him look into this matter.
I see.
This so-called relic has been causing a lot of trouble along the coast. Everyone from raiders to just strange, unsavory types have started coming into town, trying to track it down.
If I may gain a little bit more knowledge from the situation here, are you saying that the relic is bringing an influx of adventures into Waynesboro, and that might have something to do with the illness?
Yes, I've people like nothing. You keep coming in droves.
In droves? Droves?
Yes.
Oh, droves. My. Do you think that there's, and I apologize if this may seem superstitious, but overlaying mystical nature of the fact that we, as outsiders, colonists, may be imposing our will upon this striking arboreum of trees?
I don't believe in all that weird spiritual mumbo jumbo. What I do believe is that all of you random people coming through town, God knows what you've dragged through with you.
Well, I would like to think that us four in particular are not one to be put into blame since we only just arrived.
That's true. He's very right.
Good. Thank you. Thank you, Chance.
Do I know you?
Madam? I figured eventually you would recognize my figure. Chance Bordeaux, adventurer, famed explorer, and all-around humblest guy he knows.
She pulls out a notebook with a pen, glares at you, and then just writes something in it, then takes it and puts it back into her pocket. All while meeting your gaze.
Chance does not stop locking eyes with her and just stares like as deep as possible.
I am not impressed, tiny man.
I'm so sorry. I understand that Mr. Bordeaux here can be a fascinating subject. However, I would like to get back on the matter of this coastal venture that you have planned out for us. What of a particular interest, Dr. Tavarek, do you think worth investigating that's there?
You see, the only real interest I have in it is that it appears that, or from what we've heard, a lot of the people who are going disappearing are disappearing in the vicinity of the cave where this relic is supposedly hidden.
Oh, the relic is close? It's within walking distance of Waynesboro?
Jonathan stands up with half a muffin in his mouth. Where's the cave?
Well, I may have known where it was this whole time. It's Nanki that led me to it once, and I all of this rumble tumble about the relic, and I just thought it might be better for me to keep it under my hat, so to speak.
Dr. Tavarek, you do realize that, per the general just saying right here, that relic is the whole recourse of why there is an influx of potential petri dishes of virus and bacteria that's coming into this place. I think we should go investigate it immediately.
Hold up there, fancy britches. It sounds like there are how many other adventurers there? Look, I'm one for exploration, but I feel like we should have a plan going in here. I don't know what we're getting involved with.
Oh, right, well, right. No, I agree. I agree completely. And myself not being particularly suited to these types of ventures, I have enlisted General Lee's support, and she'll be escorting you along this mission. And I do believe General Lee, and he looks over to her and she says, right, and I mean, well, how proficient are you in combat?
Before I answer that question, if I may ask another question, General Lee, what exactly, beyond just being a friend of Dr. Tavarek, do you have to gain from learning more about this relic? Is this the first time you've heard of this, or did Dr. Tavarek already brief you?
I couldn't give a rat's ass about the relic.
Well, fair enough.
I'm really only here out of friendship to Dr. Tavarek. We embarked on a sort of adventure. I was hired by the military to escort him on a different diplomatic mission several months ago. And since then, you could say we became fast friends.
Yes, I...
When I heard he needed my help, I felt, I don't know, obligated to come out here and help him.
I do understand.
Awful backwater.
Say no more. Well, I. It seems so convenient that it's at the caves that only Dr. Tavarek seems to know. This is, if they have Dr. Tavarek, you're the one that may know, then Jonathan and Chance, I don't see much danger in just investigating it with the fair general here. It seems that no other adventurer has found it, or at least presumably.
Well, nor do I, and you asked about our combat prowess, General. I'll just let you know. We'll probably be able to take care of ourselves. I'm quite handy with a blade here, and Giles has shot his fair amount of foes with that trusty blunderbuss, and Chance could probably help.
A blunderbuss. Sort of just like touches her sniper rifle, like, you know, a little bit, and she's just like, blunderbuss. I didn't even know they still made those.
Well, unfortunately, we aren't as sufficiently armed as the Schlechtenberg military, so we must make do with what we have and to what our finances allow.
Quite. And at this time, Dr. Tavarek sort of motions to Chance, and he says, Mr. Bordeaux, I think you did ask me to send for one of your companions yesterday. Did you not? Maybe they could also help you on this journey?
I figured after our last run-in with whatever that was, we could use some more help.
Right. Well, I did send him word that you were coming, and I do believe he's waiting at the local tavern for you whenever you are ready.
Excellent. Before he leaves the room, Chance sort of walks up to the other characters and sort of whispers at them, like, just wait up for me. I'll meet you outside in a little bit. I've got to go find a colleague of mine.
Kind of nods.
I shrug my shoulder and start looking at maps.
So, Chance, what do you do in this situation?
I guess head straight to the appointed meeting location to go find my colleague.
And there you find a strapping mercenary with a honestly quite ludicrously large sword. And this gentleman is known to you as Brom.
Brom sets his mug down on the table, wipes his mouth, looks to the door, shrugs, turns back to his ale, drinks another draft, and says, into the cup, I'd recognize that silhouette anywhere. Chance Bordeaux, you old tosser.
Well, look who brought himself out of the mire and muck to come on an adventure with me again. What are you? I figured you couldn't resist.
Coin purse is feeling a little light these days, Chance. Felt like it was about time to head out again. Here, you've got something interesting for me this time? Something about fish?
Oh, my friend, we have got something much more exciting this time.
Do tell.
Oh, turns out there's an artifact, one that our fellow adventurers are very keen on finding.
Valuable?
Very valuable. Something I'm looking to add to a collection of sorts.
Excellent. Excellent. Nearby, guarded, in need of this, and then he just sets this huge slab of metal down on the floor. Clunk.
That, my friend, is the problem. I'm not sure.
Better safe than sorry. Drain the last of my mug. Enough talk. Let's get out of here.
A big, well-endowed barmaid comes across with another two flagons of ale and puts another one down in front of you. It gives you a nice little pat on the head. And she goes, oh, I like big boys who have big appetites. And she turns around and everything jiggles. And makes her way back behind the bar.
Everything.
Big appetite.
Everything jiggles.
Do I know this woman's name?
No.
Chance grabs the drink, chugs it all, and slams it down on the table and looks at his buddy and slaps him on the back and says, "I'll give it 10 minutes to get a digits." Walks away.
Yeah, Brom sort of shifts in his seat a little bit. And then he walks over to the bar with his mug of ale. He leans across, he locks eyes with the woman, he says, "I didn't order this." He sets down the mug of ale and he turns away.
She's sitting there with a mug of ale. She watches you leave. And then she looks over at the barkeep and she just says, "Well, that guy was cringy as fuck." And then we cut to our adventurers who are waiting outside Dr. Tabarak's home. And he's actually packing together some of your, he's sort of buffering your ration supply and helping refill your packs with food and bandages and things like that, and giving you advice as he's kind of getting you ready for this journey. You know, it is quite great of you, you know, to just embark on this, especially because we don't really know what's going on. I do hope you're not just in it for the relic, Mr. Fortinsworth.
Oh, of course not. I'm a man of science and I'm a man of exploration. For me, the caves are just as interesting as this unknown relic that you're talking about. I, at this point, by the way, I am taking items out of my backpack and I'm with Nanki and I'm holding each one up and trying to let her pick which one is more important to her. Mm-hmm. Like, I hold both up and I'm waiting to see which one she likes more, engaging her reaction on each item that I pull out of my backpack.
Amazing.
No, of course not. I am, first of all, wealth is of no importance to me versus the knowledge that can be gained from this amazing area outside. If I might only bring back a bit of this knowledge back to my father, then I will have considered this entire thing quite a success. Not only that, but the people of Wade's Herald do seem to be quite a charming folk, and I would hate to see them suffer from something that is of a piscious nature.
At this moment, Nanki has taken one of your many spyglasses and she is using it to look very awkwardly right into Jonathan Jericho's face. She's maybe not even 12 inches away, and she has a spyglass just up to your face. And
Jonathan very gently pushes the spyglass down, smiles over at Nanki, and picks up just a fork from the table, smiling very bigly, gives it to her, is like, yeah, this is better, right?
Nanki, that is a spyglass, and that is used for seeing far distances, very far away.
She pushes the fork aside, ignores what Mr. Fortinsworth says, and continues to just look at each of you in the party with her spyglass.
That's so interesting. It's wonder if her optical senses require something like spyglass just to see how we see commonly. Oh, fascinating.
Jonathan, realizing he's not going to get her to stop, actually takes the end of the spyglass, opens his mouth,
and just puts her at her.
She gets really confused about what's going on. You just hear her go, "Oh."
Yeah.
And she pushes it deeper in your mouth and starts looking around inside your mouth.
I try until it gets to the near the gag reflex to allow it to happen, and I have to cough a little bit.
I'm gonna pat Nanki on the back and kind of, as you do with most things that are fascinating, whether distract her with something else as I bring her back to my bag to show her more things, to get it out of Jonathan's mouth at least.
Yeah, she'll follow you. She likes all of your trinkets and odds and ends.
Oh, my Dr. Tavarek, I do say, no matter how this happens, I would love to come back and spend more time with Nanki, but I do say that it is already midday and we should probably get moving.
Ah, yes, I'm sure your friends will return any moment now. And generally is sitting outside, you know.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize that they weren't back yet, so my apologies.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah. So they're sitting out, you know, she's sitting, you guys are all sitting outside just getting everything together. And General Lee is outside as well, sitting in the sun, polishing her gun, pulling it apart, and putting it back together again. And it's here that Chance sort of approaches you with a sort of rough-looking gentleman at his side.
Gentlemen, I bring you a friend who's going to help us on this little expedition. Introductions. This is Giles Fork and Spoon. He is attracted to that general over there. I don't quite remember her name. That is Johnny J. Very nice. And Nunky. Oh, and Tavaraka. Wonderful people, I'm sure. We have another. She's a fish, I think. I don't. This is an adventure, let me tell you.
I've heard of your exploits. Very nicely done in the mines.
Oh, that's a Fork and Spoon.
Oh, were you directing to me? Oh, are you familiar with the mine?
Wait, did you just say Fork and Spoon?
Yeah.
Yes, it's Fortin's, by the way, if I'm Fortin's worth, but yes. I'm sorry, I didn't get your name?
Never mind.
Well, you have me at advantage then, so you have me at a disadvantage then. I am happy to have a friend of Chance's, and he is a friend of Chance's is a friend of ours.
I'm Brom. Nice to meet you.
Brom. Well met. Pick up Jonathan, a glass of something and drink it. I don't know what it is.
Jonathan reaches out for a handshake. Where are you from, Brom?
From Schlechtenberg. It's just too closed there now. Town too populated. The police force too aggressive. Thought I'd try my luck out here.
You mentioned the mines, Brom. Do you know my father?
What was his name?
Count Fortinswith.
Well, by reputation, maybe.
Yes, yes. I do so look forward to hearing about your exploits. I am assuming you are coming to aid us in case of any issues, troubles that we might run across?
Heard you all might need a little protection. Seems like you're probably the sort of people who can get themselves into trouble with their mouths.
Let me tell you about it.
And if I may ask, who is paying for this protection at the moment?
Chance is.
Chance, how generous of you.
I told you I'm famous. It comes with perks.
Famous, that's one word for it, says General Lee as she continues to sort of line her sights up on her gun.
If I may, Jasmine, can mm-hmm. I, because Giles is not as stupid as he may necessarily put himself out yes. to be, mm-hmm. Can I read his intent a little bit? Because now I'm starting to feel like there's a lot of attention that's being brought to our party as a yeah. result of going to this relic.
Definitely. Go ahead and roll for it.
What would you say? Deception? Persuasion? Perception.
Perception.
I'm going to sprint to the bathroom while he does this real quick.
All right. Let's roll it up. Roll, roll. Roll it up. Roll, roll. Womp, 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 womp.
Oh, no.
yeah, that's cool. A solid 7.
A solid 7. So,
yeah.
You try to read into Chance's sort of demeanor a little bit, or try to read his intentions, and on the surface, you don't really think the dude is probably on the up and up. And just as you're sort of looking over his shoulder, you almost see off in the distance the silhouette of that same person you were following back in the forest. But you only see it in the crowd and the hustle and bustle of the street for a moment before it shifts away.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Oh my. I look up to the direction of where that silhouette was and go, Jonathan, did you see that?
What?
Jonathan, that's the silhouette of the creature that we presume to be Dahlia seemed to have just appeared in the crowd for a moment.
Really?
Yes, I swear, I just saw her. I think, unfortunately, we can assume that it is either Dahlia or not, but she is the one who led us into this town.
I definitely saw her too.
Oh, I just saw her again. Should we pursue? I feel like we should.
Let's go see.
We are going to take that breadcrumb that you just put in front of us, and we're going to eat it up.
Good. It's totally not like you failed a perception roll, so that might be a bogus breadcrumb.
Who cares? I rolled it.
Good. I like it. It's my immersion right now. So.
I react off of bad dice rolls.
So. Yes, yes. So,
it was a strange town. What other markers of stranger to you do I see around?
Well, as you walk, General Lee is sort of bringing up the rear, and she points out different landmarks, different places where they've.
I'm going to have you hold for a little bit. We lost audio, so we're trying to refresh the source.
We will hold for a moment then.
Mannequin challenge?
So I still have audio? Oh, okay. I thought we had lost all audio. Those of you watching, thank you again for tuning in to Open Legend. Today we're joined by Silent0siris and Jesse Cox as our special guests as part of our normal cast, BaerTaffy and Ivan Van Norman. Next week we'll be joined by Matthew Mercer, and Aureylian will be back. So, she might be a fish next week, but she'll be back. That'll be cool. And for those of you who are watching, just so you know, today is Freaky Friday. Oh, I don't think that's supposed to come out of there.
Well, it's not.
Ah, okay. Today is Freaky Friday, so for every sub, we are giving away a free Steam key. And every 5 subs, a portal may or may not open inside of our strange setting, and things will come out of the portal. It could be good, it could be bad. We'll roll for it and figure it out, and our adventurers will then have to deal with it. That's where we're at now. Unless you had anything else? Deal with it.
I can't wait for that's gonna be quite the plot twist.
Yeah, well,
I hope that she gains like a new advantage or a new bane. Oh yeah. Almost.
It'll all depend on how quickly you guys can secure her aid.
Let's do this.
are we ready to go?
No,
so
we're
we should move very slowly.
We're really good at that. We're really good at moving very slowly.
Probably our strongest asset.
If you ask me, our best advantage for finding a woman in town is to go door by door through the entire village. Definitely shouldn't split up to cover more ground.
Zoom meeting ID is 68-953-678 window.
So who do you think is most likely to die?
Who do I think is most likely to die?
Who's most likely to die? Not who you want to die.
No, I don't want anyone to die. I feel bad saying this because I love Giles, but I think right now Giles is cruising for a bruising.
Yeah. What did I do?
It asked who I think is going to die. Your character is way too inquisitive and way too squishy to be inquisitive. Yes. Yes. Very squishy. Not a lot of combat prowess. I worry for you all the time, constantly. As a GM, I'm just like, this poor man. What is going to happen to him? Our lovely Giles Fortenworth. Fork and spoon, actually.
You can refresh the source?
this is a great time to present you with a chocolate covered pretzel, because you deserve it. It's only
This is such a weird, speaking of, I don't know if you noticed, but I don't have sound though.
Yep, we are, we are good guys. Sorry about that. We had an HDMI converter fail on us mid-show, so welcome to live TV production. It's great.
I did my best to entertain you while they fixed it. And now I have a chocolate-covered pretzel. It is. I think it is. I think things broke more often than I get more chocolate-covered pretzels, but...
Can you hear them?
Barely. But I can't hear them.
Shall we venture forth into
I hear it.
Yes. So...
figure in the darkness or in the midday, whatever it is.
It is early morning, or by this time actually, it's probably about mid-morning, late morning. Yeah. And as you're walking through this town, General Lee is taking it upon herself to point out various landmarks to you. And she talks about different area or different sites of previous battles and her own adventures and exploits inside this strange town, as well as she gives you a little bit of the history of the town, why it's called Woe's Herald, such a scary sort of name for a seemingly pretty innocent looking town. She tells you that this town was originally built by the Nivenellians, who are very proficient with modifying the genetics of living creatures and sort of bending that to their will. And she kind of explains to you guys that a lot of the time they will use coral and cellulose and materials like this to build their homes instead of the type of materials Schlechtenbergians would use, like, you know, brick or metal or things like that. And she also tells you it's known as Woe's Herald because at some point the Nivenellians abandoned the settlement when they came, when the original sort of random settlers, not really settlers, adventurers found it and originally founded this town, the town was already abandoned. And this was a ghost town. They still don't know why it was originally abandoned. And so it kind of gained this sinister reputation. That combined with the fact that the coastal area nearby is very treacherous for ships to sail near. A lot of ships have sort of met their doom upon the jagged coral and rocks along the coastline. Soon the town came to be known, at least to the local Schlechtenberg folk, as Woe's Herald.
Pity the folk of the town couldn't bend the coral in the water out of the way of their boats.
No, well, those would be the elves are the people who can bend the coral. Not your European settlers.
The elves.
Yeah. I would, I am... Unfortunately, it would seem that they have left in a hurry, or did it seem... Was there anything left beyond just the buildings?
It was completely wiped out. Completely cleaned out.
Any sign of bodies? Any sign of...
Nothing.
Genocide of sorts?
No. Which only led to the strange rumors and eeriness of this town.
Well, let's hope that whatever caused the Nivenellians to be driven out of Woe's Herald, we do not stumble upon.
I can agree with that, General Lee says. And then she says, sort of like, dejectedly, she's like, yes, I mean, technically I don't think I'm supposed to be
up.
Here.
Volume up.
That threw me off so much.
Volume up. Volume up.
Oh, no, that was Jonathan. He's an android. He's trying
to... Some of these are usually loud, but they're quiet. We don't know why.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Zoom's really quiet right now, and we can't figure out why.
Sorry, guys. Once again, Zoom has decided to be really quiet.
Tip. Share screen. Alt plus S.
Why?
Well, I don't know why.
Why
it's
is it doing that? The computer's talking to us, and we don't know why.
Hal, leave us alone.
Volume down.
For some reason, everybody's really quiet, and we cannot figure out why. And
menu.
It seems. Oh my God,
Use
Zoom.
Audio. Chat. Spotlight video.
Zoom menu is the item. Worst. Oh my God.
Why is it doing text to speech?
I don't know. This is the worst.
I will eat your children in the evening.
Obviously, the computer volume is really loud. It's just you guys' voices decide to all of a sudden be really quiet. And there's no option to adjust unless it's in the windows.
I was going to say it might
volume
be
is deaf.
Okay. QQ, make sure you go full screen on bronze really quick.
With start menu.
Pay, oh my. Mail. The whole computer is
launch
doing
mail. Non-selected. Draggable. Column 1, row 1.
It's not creepy.
Oh my god, stop it!
It's not creepy. Not even a little bit.
Zoom meeting ID. Start menu. Pane. Mail.
I think you hit a hotkey that's doing text to speech.
Tooltip. Exit full screen.
Oh my god!
Meeting ID. 638-953-678. Alt plus F.
Stop looking. Don't look at me. I didn't do it.
Oh my god. ID, this is the worst fucking thing ever.
Volume 100%. Slide.
Hashtag technical difficulties.
Zoom meeting ID 638-953-678 window.
Oh, I thought this is just like we're being very techie while describing folders. Oh, I was like, god. I don't know what the hell are talking colon? I was like, what? Unless really you're just looking like for muscle men, comma, colons. In which case...
Tooltip. Speaker view. Alt plus F1.
Very niche fetish, man. Not very many people are servicing that one.
Muscled colons. That's, you know...
Volume up. Tooltip. Volume down.
Money.
Huh? Disable the text-to-speech accessibility.
How do you do that?
It should be in the settings, I think.
In the settings, great.
For the computer itself.
For the computer itself.
Speech accessibility.
How did that get turned on?
No idea. We just hit the volume up button. So that's cool.
I would like to access my speech.
Tooltip. Exit full screen. Meeting ID. 638-953-678. Alt plus F. Volume mixer. APHDMIRX. Intel. R. Display audio.
God damn. Okay, this is officially the stupidest thing I've ever seen a computer do in the middle of a show.
We'll get it sorted out.
Welcome, everyone, to trying to troubleshoot things live. This is amazing.
This process is amazing.
Mm-hmm. PC settings. Let's ease of access. Narrator.
We
is turned on for some stupid fucking reason. It's also creating these blue boxes on screen that won't go away.
I see that now.
Yeah. Great. Okay, well that's gone.
We don't
gone.
Have someone narrating our life anymore. This isn't Banner Saga.
No.
Hello,
go away, Mr. Narrator. Also, yes, great game. Did you play the second one, Banner Saga?
Yeah, oh, real good.
Yes.
Real good.
Yeah.
I hear that one's even better.
Yep, it is.
Yep.
Yeah, I think so.
Are they the appropriate volume?
Don't really know.
Hello?
Hey, you know what? And just in time for you to finish your chocolate-covered pretzel.
There's a little bit left, but...
When that automatically
turned
on,
about.
It lowered their volume.
Oh! I didn't touch it. It was not me.
It wasn't you. It wasn't
okay.
you.
Okay. All right.
We are currently pursuing the... specter that is darting through.
You don't know that it's a specter.
Well, we don't know if it's a specter, but it's definitely a shapeless form in which we are pursuing after. And in the meantime, getting a glorious tour guide as we are moving through trying to find her. Look at our tour guide.
Well, you had a lot of questions, and so General Lee has taken upon herself to answer most of them.
Oh, and I have even more questions as we go along.
Well, now's your chance to get them out of the way.
Actually, I don't have any more questions at the moment. I'll let you know if I have any more.
Do we know where the elven graveyards are?
Elven graveyards?
Yes.
Not around here, not that I know of.
Very good. So the town is perhaps not, in fact, built on top of elven graveyards.
Is this guy for real? She looks at you, Giles.
Unfortunately, it would appear so. Unless his humor is drier than that of my father's brother.
I lean in and say, I think he's trying to go by process of elimination.
And another note, the Niminalians obviously are not pleased with Schlechtenbergens, if that might be what we call ourselves, coming Schlechtenbergers coming into these areas. Have you seen any other signs of hostility from the Niminalians up to this point? Or are they just content to
take advantage of poor explorers like our little team here.
Hmm. Well, clearly you're new here.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, shamefully I have to admit that those of us of Moondew Watch maybe didn't leave the best first impression when we came through the portal.
Right.
I've been here since we opened the portal.
Were you deployed originally through the portal?
Yes.
Ah, excellent.
And I was a part of a lot of the initial diplomatic sort of envoys that were sent to the different elven groups to try to make peace.
Huh. And how did that go?
Well, let's just say we didn't know enough about the locals, and we had kind of been manipulated by the government into thinking that maybe they were more primitive and savage than they actually are. And it made some of our original peacekeeping efforts go south very quickly.
I see. Well, knowing...
When I first met Nanki, I shot her.
Oh, well, that's unfortunate. She doesn't seem like one you would shoot at. Would she...
No, but...
Did she give you that impression when you first saw her?
I'm sorry, what?
Did she give you that first impression when you saw her?
I'm trying to paint a picture of how we were sort of manipulated into feeling that these creatures were outwardly hostile.
I understand.
Chance laughs hysterically and he's like, they killed so many of them.
Lee just stares at you with a cold, like icy cold stare.
By the way, I'm coming out, Jasmine, a little bit. Are we making any pacing in trying to find this?
Yes,
or are
you're
we
just
wandering
conversation
in circles
while walking? Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so let us know if we actually ever catch up to this damn thing.
Yeah, definitely.
Mrs. Helm. One more thing, then. If you are obviously effectively the military specialist here that is most informed of this area around. With Woe's Herald especially, have you seen anything that would cause you to suppose that having us move in could be a trap? For example, if the Niminellians truly felt like that the place was not worth keeping anymore, they would do it for one of two reasons, either because they felt like the presence of the Schlechtenburns were either too not to their liking and they decided to formulate a settlement elsewhere, or they laid a very clever, very, well, alluring trap.
It's not outside the realm of possibility. We really don't know what we're getting into here.
Yes.
Now, I know that some of the locals have some stories about this relic site or what may or may not be there, but in terms of what I think may have caused the disease, or the epidemic, I think some strange elven curse is a lot more plausible than some weird, temple?
Yeah, that's what I brought about as well, too, to discuss that initially you had said that you didn't really believe in the mystical mumbo-jumbo of potentially an elven curse. Is there a possibility that this relic is instead imposing its will of the Niminellian, since these Abomancers, as they call themselves, appear to have good connections to the genes of those that are living.
Right. Abomancer. So you've had run-ins with House Valurian, as we call them.
Yes, we most certainly have, and I will say we probably got as warm as a reception as you were used to.
Elven houses are all... They all adopt different attitudes towards those of us from Moondew Watch, but it's safe to say that the Valurian are easily the most hostile, as well as the most strange. I have seen things while scouting out their camps that I can't even really put words to.
Fortunate to get out of there in time, then. So,
are any of the elven houses actively allied with us?
We have a decent relationship with House Niminellia as of right now. As for the third elven house, although we've seen them, we haven't had very much contact with them yet, but outwardly they don't seem overly warlike. As far as the Valorian go, it seems like they don't even get along with some of their own kind.
Ah, are they, well, even if you describe they're originally as savages, but they are the most warlike of their guilds, you could say.
And just twisted.
Well, duly noted. And you say this was an old Nivenellian outpost or a Valorian outpost?
Nivenellian.
Nivenellian, excellent. Mm-hmm. And so this relic could potentially be of original design by the Nivenellians?
Oh, I have no idea.
I so want to find out. This originally was fascinating me when Dahlia first spoke about it, but the fact that it's so close to us now just excites my tiny brain.
The rumors have been spreading far and wide about this strange object. I'm not quite sure what it is, what it does. All I know is that Tabaric wants us to go check it out.
Yeah, and only you and Tabaric know about it. That also fascinates me.
Oh, well, there's that. That's why I originally was brought here.
Right,
Nanki went missing in the area that is rumored to be where the relic was. And that's actually how I came upon the opening to the cave.
You do know that some Schlechtenbergs would pay handsomely for Nivenellian artifacts on the other side of the portal, correct?
We can discuss that if we get through this.
I'm less concerned about that, and I'm actually more concerned with the fact that you haven't taken advantage of it yet.
Oh, I don't really care about that kind of stuff, honestly.
Good, then we are of like mind.
Yeah.
I think Chance and I share a glance back behind the camera.
Okay. I don't think I have any more questions for Helen.
Good, because we're approaching at least the outskirts of the town, and things might get a little sticky from here on out.
Okay.
I haven't been this way for a while. I'm kind of helping out Tabaric while on military leave. I've been sort of doing rounds of the camp and keeping watch. I'm the only one here with any real military background.
Yes, you two both seem to be audaciously close.
Yes. We've had a few adventures together. Tabaric has... Let's just say I may or may not owe him one or two. But I still don't know what he hopes to accomplish from this dangerous expedition. Personally, I don't think any random relic is really worth it. But he did tell me that if we were able to come back with a specimen of one of these so-called town folk that have gone missing, it could help him figure out what's going on with people and maybe find a cure to slow or even reverse the effects.
Aren't the town folk inside the village still? Even our own friend is currently in his upstairs. Why can't he take a sample from them?
He could, but we need something, we need a sample from one of the more advanced specimens.
I see, since they tend to go missing.
But we have heard from some town folks' reports of them seeing their loved ones sort of shambling off in this direction.
Oh my, excellent. Well, we have, definitely a little bit of, a discovery ahead of us. I do not think we're going to find what we're looking for around this creature. Seems to have been constantly out of our reach. What say you, team, that we head back to the caves?
About that, I didn't see anything. I kind of just took all of your word for it.
Wait, and to be fair, I don't have anything else. Sorry, Jasmine, I'll speak to you directly if I could. There's nothing else that we've seen or that could potentially incite any other curiosities at this stage?
Not as of right now, no. Your adventure through the town has been relatively eventless.
Well, then we've wasted enough time. Let's get going.
Generally.
And as you leave the town and you're now sort of making your way through a coastal jungle type of environment, generally, you know, crouches down and checks the ground for tracks and, you know, looks over at Chance and says, are you sure you saw something? I'm an excellent tracker and I just don't see anything here.
Can
if
I
someone came through this way, I would know.
Can Brom help with the tracking? Yes, I guess.
Oh, what?
Can I help with the tracking?
Oh, yes, you may. Sorry, okay. I didn't hear.
So this is the first roll that I've ever made in Open Legends. I'm rolling perception and I'm trying to beat what my resolve.
No, she's got a challenge rating. She's got a challenge rating setting to yours, and the difference is that you'll have an attribute die depending on how skillful you are.
Which I do. I'm very perceptive. Well, moderately perceptive. Yeah, all right. I guess as we've been going, I've also been like leaning down and brushing my fingers against the dirt and smelling them and looking up through it. Are there trees nearby? What's the general environment?
So it's like a tropical forest. The trees are sort of tall and wispy, and they have like vines coming down. And the area in general looks like something that goes between being flooded and then that water receding. It's a little bit wet and soggy.
Okay, so yeah, I'm
there's
like...
There's not a lot of brush, though. You can see pretty far ahead.
Okay, so like I take a look at any branches that are maybe snapped or shreds of hair or cloth hanging on anything, trying to see if there's anything that we can use to our advantage. 17. Wow.
17, perfect. So you sort of, while you're looking, you manage to see a small light footprint in the corner, and you point it out to Chance. You can draw everyone else's attention to it or not.
Oh, I think Chance and I share a quick word quietly before we draw everybody else's attention to it. Mm-hmm. Bordeaux, what do you make of this? Are we going in the right direction? We're looking for someone small. You said it was a footprint. Does it look like it has any sort of fish-like attributes?
No, it actually looks like a woman's heeled boot.
Before I found you today, we were tracking something similar last night. Something, I don't know what it was. Apparently one of their own betrayed them or some such nonsense, but they're on the path of something, and I believe she's on it as well.
The same figure that the others were searching for through the town?
I think so.
Hey, Fork and Spoon.
I am Fultonsworth, yes.
Look at this.
I look down.
Booted footprint.
Yes, this would be in line with one of Dahlia's boot prints, for sure. It's insane that she would leave us to die with the with the Valorians, and then at the same time mysteriously stay one step ahead of us inside of Wade's Woe's Herald.
No one's General... dying here today, Pansy Boy.
Well, but I have you to thank for that. But I would prefer something other than Pansy.
Blessing bridges.
General Lee takes a look at the step as well and like scratches her head really confused. And she's like, but there's no other steps, and the placement of it is so strange. And she just sits there and stares at it. She's like, there's something off about this. This can't be right.
Miss Dahlia, had she any supernatural abilities? Could this be some sort of jump or flying leap?
She is a member of the Mages Society, so I am told. So.
Well, there you go. That explains the foot. That explains the shade. Explains everything.
Well, then it appears if Dahlia does not want to make herself visible to us, then we shall, as they say, walk with dignity as she sits in her lurking position with whatever design she has. But I encourage all of us to stay on the alert.
Is there a way that I can detect magic?
Yeah, you can try from, let's see. Why don't you try rolling? I'm gonna go ahead and say you could do another perception roll.
Okay, yeah, as the others decide that they've made up their minds and are moving away, I stay back just a little bit and I open my mind and my senses of magical perception.
Okay.
Yeah, what might be happening here? Nothing. 24.
24, so from looking at it, you definitely know that yes, this is, there's a magical presence around this footstep.
Yeah, I think back through the mantras that Brom has stored in his head, his rituals, his litanies against the dark arts, and I just start reciting them to myself as I trail the group. And I loosen the bands strapping my large blade to my back as I take up a rear guard position.
All right.
Well, next time you see this witch or whatever. Let me know. I could probably take her out from here.
Excellent. Well, and if it's Dahlia, then she shouldn't be stalking us so eerily. I think it is best that we find our way to these caves, because unfortunately our friend Nim is, her life could be at stake. So can I use some logic to assume pretty much how long either she has based on the information that I get from Dr. Tavarek?
Yeah, definitely. Go for it.
All right. Logically, she has this much time to live. Do, 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 do. Getting to my roll 20.
Not long.
Right, 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 right. There you are. Do, do, do. Go away. I am full of suck today. 12.
12. So, based off of the other accounts of this strange condition that Dr. Tavark and you just like he told you about, he gave you accounts of, you know that she probably has a couple of days roughly, but okay. You're not sure exactly how much.
Before she could disappear.
Before she could disappear, yeah.
Yeah, okay. All right. Well, then let's get going.
So, General Lee continues to lead you through this sort of muggy, coastal rainforest, and
if I could, I'd like to pull Giles aside as we're walking for a second here. Jonathan, I've become a little bit suspicious of Brom's sudden inclusion in the troop.
I am, yes, as well.
Along with the new findings of Dahlia having definitely, you know, well, we figured she left us out to dry, but now Jonathan's beginning to think that there's also something else amiss with her, as I'm sure the group is. I say to Giles, there's something off about all of this, isn't there?
Yes, the perceived value of this artifact seems to have a lot of ulterior designs in motion, it would appear. I would not be surprised if we found Dahlia a bit closer to our goal, as she would appear. Not only that, but Mr. Chance's new friend here, he seems to have been bringing in ones favoring his designs more than our own. Jonathan, may I trust in you to have only the most purest of intents in this journey that we are undertaking?
Well, you don't need to worry about me, but Brom, he's an interesting one.
Right. One worth observing more. I will endeavor to keep close observation on him. So, at this stage, I think it would be worth Giles's attitude in order to, because I haven't had a chance to use this yet, and I think now is the best time of all, is to craft a beneficial item for me, since that seems to be something
okay. We
need when we get in here. Now, I can only do something that is a 3 or higher to get a benefit of 1. So that's either logic, perception, or learning. I'm already killing it on learning. But I think a perception at this point would probably be worthwhile in order to catch things. So, yeah, I would like to create a permanent beneficial item. Or actually, it's a baleful item. I can make a baleful item if I wish as well, too.
Mm-hmm.
Permanent or expendable. A potion or scroll may be expended. Then item triggers the heal boon, for example, while the ring of invisibility may be a permanent item that triggers the invisibility boon when it conceals it. So I'm going to create a permanent item.
Okay. What do you want to create?
I would like to create something that will essentially give me a little bit better perception when it comes to either like a sixth sense, like maybe something like a whizding, like something that vibrates when something comes towards me. Like if there's anything invisible that's trying to stalk up on me, or people get too close into Giles's comfort zone. I think having like a whiz ding or something that either makes a loud noise or makes a vibrates or something would be super beneficial right now.
Definitely. So while tinkering about in your items, you are able to create an add-on to your blunderbuss.
Awesome.
And it sort of makes your blunderbuss make a loud sort of rattling sound, wherever it seems to be hanging or sitting down.
I imagine it being like a little gyroscope that yes, maybe is like yes, a bunch of spheres on it, and it just spins really fast with a clanky
yep,
marble.
Exactly. That's exactly what I envisioned as well. So you've created this sort of add-on for your blunderbuss. When things are within about 30 feet of you, you will then be immediately notified.
Cool. 30 feet, that's huge. I'll
yes,
take it.
Yes. So. I am a generous god.
Yeah, thank you. 30 feet, Whizdinger.
Mm-hmm. So as you're wandering through this coastal forest, generally slows down and starts to kind of look through the undergrowth, and she, you kind of pick up on the fact that she sees something. And sure enough, you come across an abandoned camp. And looking through it, she very quickly sort of tells you all, looks like what would easily be described as bandits. And she sort of rolls through the packs and she's kind of weirded out because she doesn't see any remains. But it seems like the camp has been abandoned for a long time, and it looks like it was abandoned in haste.
Why would bandits just abandon their gear? It's their livelihood.
So the gear is all there?
Yes.
Anything useful?
You can look for something useful.
Yeah, I'd like to look for something for sure, if I can.
Yeah.
I'm going to keep my wits about me.
We're going on perception for that?
Roll for that?
Perception roll? Yes?
Yes.
Okay.
Is there, like, can I just give him advantage by assisting him in his search?
Yeah, you can do that if you want.
I go search along with, what's your name again? Jonathan Jericho. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, because he's helping you, yeah, we can, oh.
Wow. Maybe I should have helped you.
Oh, did you not have any,
No, yeah, I wow. That was, that was so possible.
Going off that wonderful roll, Chance goes through some of the bags and discovers they have copies of his book. And he is very pleased, just like.
And you just sign it right there and put it back inside of the bag.
Seeing that Jonathan Jericho has found nothing useful in the bags or anything like that, I'm going to try to apply a little logic here and say, you know, these bandits, they wouldn't have had nothing useful on them. But maybe if I were a bandit, I would have hid it and logic out another hiding place for something interesting.
Yeah, okay, roll for it.
Awesome.
Can I, in turn, assist here, or would that be maybe a little too overkill?
I'm sorry, what?
Can I assist him now in turn? Now that he's helped me out, I can maybe...
You can try to, yeah.
Sure.
Okay, so that gives, me advantage, I guess?
Yes, I would give you a plus one advantage.
Okay, well, that was... Wait.
Your rolls today are not great.
But it didn't roll with advantage.
Oh, it didn't?
I'm only seeing one...
No, you got D20. One. You got plus one to it, and you got a D4, so it's four... And then I think, oh no, but then you got a one on that.
Because I'm only seeing the four from the D20 plus the one from the D4, but there's not a second D20, right?
Mm-hmm. No, it's not. It's not advantage like you would think in fifth edition.
Got
advantage
it.
Basically gives you a literally a one to your roll. So,
wow. Dang.
Yeah. Versus a disadvantage, which also will reduce numbers from it as well.
Right. Yeah. All right, cool. No, Brom's got nothing.
So, while trying to think about a special hiding place for where the bandits may have kept some of their valuables, you're probably right, but while looking around the camp, you can't seem to surmise where that hiding place would be, so you don't find anything of value. You find your typical things, some old moldy rations, some weapons of poor make, just random survival equipment, and generally it looks really uncomfortable with the entire situation. And she says, for them to leave like this, something must have happened. It seems like it happened weeks ago. Maybe we should leave this area.
Right, of course. Whatever scared them off, we don't want to run into ourselves. But you said this camp seems to have been abandoned for weeks?
Well, I mean, yes. Look at these rations. They're old.
Yeah,
look at the fire. Look at the tents. And she starts pointing out to you things that... that to her are obvious, that but to you probably are not.
Yeah. All right. Well, it seems this is a bit more dangerous. I am going to move next to our good friend. I already forgot, and it's not on the character list here. Our newest friend of the evening.
Brom, my dear friend.
Brom, I'm going to sit next to Brom and take my blunderbuss out.
General Lee.
Yes.
Speaking, what do you find as a threat in this environment, generally?
Out here? Well, during my patrols and sort of scouting I've done out here, mostly I've just found wildlife and the occasional cutthroat, but that's about it. Not anything I couldn't handle.
What do you think might have caused them to leave their camp so quickly?
I haven't the faintest idea, and quite frankly, that's what makes me worry.
Yeah, I just slide the sword off my back.
Yeah. And she kind of like readies, like unstraps her sniper rifle and, you know, starts to make sure everything's in order there. And then you suddenly see her like click a button on her shoulder, and she has like a sort of light bending field come around her, and you realize she's like very, very, she has some very advanced stealth technology created by some of the awesome steampunk engineers of Schlechtenberg. And she says to you guys, I'll scout out ahead. Stay here for just a moment.
I will stay here next to Brom.
She goes out and takes a few steps, or, you know, she disappears from your sight and leaves the camp. And she'll, you know, she'll be gone for a few minutes if you want to talk amongst yourselves at all.
Jonathan approaches Chance. Find anything besides that book?
No, just seems like all of them were fans. That's good. I mean, it's unfortunate for future book sales, but it was good for the last one.
Jonathan just shakes his head. What's your friend's story?
Well, when you're one such as myself, you embark on many adventures, and I met him on one. He helped me with handling some business, and he's been a reliable friend ever since.
Certainly wouldn't have anything to do with the vast amount of money this artifact is worth. Maybe providing him some incentive.
Here's the thing, my friend. I, up until recently, had no clue this artifact existed. You're the ones who brought it to me.
I have to say, originally, that's actually, it's a very good point. We seem to have simply just found you in a cage. For all we know, you're as much of a ruffian as we are.
I mean, please, you found me. If anything, the lore of your artifact is what brought me on this adventure.
Jonathan, I do believe, unfortunately, he is right. We have made friends, and we should keep them friends until they have proven themselves not friends. But you are indeed our friends, aren't you, Chance?
Oh, was Johnny here? Was he having doubts of my eagerness in this endeavor? Please, gentlemen, I showed you the proper way to go. I introduced you to a town filled with fish people. That's an adventure.
And Jonathan, you are one for an adventure, aren't you, Chance?
I do love a good story.
Jonathan nods, just being careful, and turns around and continues looking around the camp.
At this point...
Sorry, it's superfluous, but at this point I'm literally just charcoal sketching out more of the horizon because Giles.
Yeah, Giles. Of course. I would be disappointed if you didn't.
As we wait, Brom stands, gripping his sword two-handed, simply scanning the horizon. I turn to Chance. I say, Chance, what sort of creature have you encountered out here? What threat do you know of that we might face? Is there any way for us to prepare, or are we at the mercies of the gods?
Well, I'm not quite sure what's this direction. I apparently a cave and fish people, but most of my endeavors have been in far different locations. The furthest I've ever gone this direction was back to our town, and as was explained by the general, you don't go out into the water. You can't go out into the water, so let me tell you, this is all new to me.
I understand. Bronze, so I can invoke a resistance on myself as a result of my protection skill.
Okay.
And I'm thinking, like, you know, Brom doesn't know his enemy. I'm not getting any information about what we might be up against. And so as a soldier, as a warrior, I would sort of tend to fall back on, you know, the most common threat that Brom has faced so far in his soldier career. Would that be forceful? What kind of attack type would I be most likely to want to protect myself from?
Probably slashing attacks, just because most of the opponents you would have faced would be people that probably use swords or daggers or cutting weapons of that type.
Yeah. All right. So slashing is a type that I can gain resistance to?
I believe so, yes.
Okay, cool. Mm-hmm. Yeah, then I'm going to simply invoke a resistance boon for myself against the type of slashing. Do I need to roll for that, or is it just a...
For boons, yes, you do, but you don't have to, you just have to roll up against a challenge rating.
Okay.
So, and let me get you the exact one here.
Great.
It's going to be, I think, 10 plus... 2 times the level of the boon you're trying to invoke. Let
me just make sure. This is a level 3 boon.
So it's a level 3 boon, so you'll have to roll equal to 10 plus 16. You'll have to beat a 16 on your roll.
Well, let's see what I can do. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I set my sword tip in the ground for a second, and I just start mentally reciting through a litany against slashing damage. You know, running through my mental katas, basically.
Well, let me make sure. So
it's the first time I've heard kata.
Okay, so it's actually going to be slashing. I used the wrong word. It's finesse.
Finesse? All
right, that's the word, which typically is slashing weapons. So we'll just say you have a resistance to finesse weapons.
Crushed it with a 23.
Nice. Okay, so you're able to successfully invoke the boon, and now you'll be resistant to that type of damage.
Yeah. How long does that last?
That lasts, boons kind of last indefinitely from what I know.
Got it. Cool.
Until it's no longer convenient for her.
Yep.
Yeah.
Or until, until
the duration of a scene
one.
Or, sure.
And now it's
time to move on. No threat here. Great. Okay, cool. Yeah. I am resisted. So I have resistance to that thing. Should I record that on my character sheet under agility, armor, shield, other, anything like that, or?
I think we'll just take it into account when you take damage.
Okay, so we'll just
remember. Because I believe it only affects damage.
It's my defense scores are increased by 3 against the chosen attack type. What is my defense score? Help me out here.
Oh, that's easy then. Okay, so your defense scores are going to be your evasion, your toughness, and your resolve. Aren't values you roll for. They're just static values that I roll against. So that actually makes it really simple. We'll just add a 3 to it when it's the chosen battle type. So you actually don't have to change anything on your player sheet.
Right. Awesome. Right. Very cool.
So while you're sort of preparing and sitting in this camp, all of a sudden, Giles's whizbanger starts
Whizdinger. Oh my.
Starts to whir very quickly.
Miss Helm, is that you?
You don't hear a response.
Arm yourselves, gentlemen. I believe we're going to have company.
And just as you say this, at the edge of the camp, or just outside the tree line, you start to see these strange creatures approach you, and they're almost like hounds, or at least they move like hounds, but they're made out of bark. And they have, leaves coming off of them. And they closely resemble the sort of hanging, these weird trees that are around you with their hanging vines and appendages. And there's 3 of them.
and they start to make low, almost rumbling sounds. Not growls, because they're not capable of that, but just low rumbling sounds. And they start to sort of, like, on their haunches, move towards you closely.
I've learned anything from this campaign at the moment. It is shoot it! Shoot it now! Ask questions later!
Do you do so?
I will shoot it! I will shoot the buck out.
That will put you at the top of the initiative track, and yes! Everyone else, roll for initiative!
Oh. Oh, I got a bronze token.
Can you tell me how to roll for initiative?
You can just roll a d20. So okay. You can look in your dice tray, or you can do slash roll d20.
It's not agility, it's just a d20.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
All right. So, let me keep this in. I have to keep track of this.
Mine showed up, right?
Huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you're on there. You didn't roll well, but you're on there.
Okay. Better bad than nothing.
No, so actually nothing probably would have been just as good.
Giles, Chance, Brom,
he's
and
your
Ben.
Friend. Why you gotta treat him that way?
We're all friends now, right? We learned that.
We're all friends. We're all in this together.
Friends until proven otherwise.
Yeah,
right?
We are now.
Friends until I find the motive.
Fupo.
So go ahead and roll your attack if you'd
like. Alright,
let
me roll. I will roll Blunderbuss. Blunderbuss, Blunderbuss. My agility, it's just my agility. Seventeen,
that does hit. Do you want to describe how you attack it?
I was leveling my Whizdinger and looking at it spin. Very content that it worked. I was a little bit worried, but I'm happy that it worked. And as soon as I see these bark hounds coming out, I aim at it, and without really thinking about shooting it, I kind of just leveled it at it, and it shocked Giles so much to see it that he actually just accidentally pulled the trigger and then fired the blunderbuss as it just blasts off in the middle of the area and just like buckshot just riddles the thing with pieces of bark flying everywhere.
Okay. You manage to hit the one who's sort of leading this little triad of strange woodland hound creatures. And it does, you know, the buckshot does hit it in the face, and you see chips of wood go flying. But you also see it not really break pace, and it still continues to move towards you pretty quickly.
Oh, well, that makes sense. Should I worry too much about it doing its sustained damage, or are these things going to be resistant against it?
At this time, you don't inflict any sustained damage.
Okay. I'm going to take my blunderbuss, and while reloading it, run behind Brom. That's the game of the game.
The second hound, after being startled by this sort of loud bang that's gone off, immediately sort of just streaks towards Jonathan and takes a swipe at him.
Let's see.
All right, and what is your evasion?
12.
12. I rolled a 22. So it does hit. And what is your toughness?
13.
13. So you are going to take 9 damage.
Okay.
I did that correctly. I'm pretty sure I did. Mm-hmm. Pretty sure I did.
All right.
Oh, by the way, I just found on Roll 20 where to roll initiative at. You click speed. You click speed.
Oh, well then.
Which, for the record, is usually a D for me because of agility. It was a D20 plus a D6.
Yeah, it's an agility. Yep.
Oh, and then I have to update your health here.
Do 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 do.
Okay.
So it. Oh my, Jonathan! Oh my!
It streaks towards you and just quickly, like, snaps at you. and manages to catch your arm and take, you know, just take a big gash right out of it as it as it continues on through its sort of trajectory. And then it is Chance's turn.
Chance also will fire on, I'll fire on the one that, what's actually the closest, like, where are they right now in like, in relation to us?
Mm-hmm. So, I am envisioning that towards, sort of towards the, this abandoned tent and this abandoned site, you have Brom standing at one, if we imagine it to be a half circle, Brom standing at one edge. We have Giles standing very close to him with Jonathan on his other side. One of the hounds has just streaked past Jonathan and is about to circle around for another go. The other one is in position moving towards you slowly, and the other hound behind him is still also holding position.
Okay. Can I... Oh, God. Can I try... I want to verify this is...
Mm-hmm.
Can I try to charm the one that's slowly moving towards me? Is that possible? Well, because I think I have the ability to do it on lesser humans and animals. Is this thing?
What
is
Wait, this? Have you read my book?
Yeah, like, can I charm this thing? Like, it's just an
yes,
animal.
Yes, actually, yes, I will allow it.
All right, cool. And I also have with that the power of unending charm. So.
It'll be your creature.
Let's do this. All right, here we go.
Which one are you targeting?
The one that is slowly approaching me. The one that you said was like on his haunches.
The one who got a little bit of his face taken off?
Yeah, yeah, I'll call him Old Chippy.
Okay.
If this works. All right, here we go. Oh, that's not right. Uh-oh.
So an easier way
it's
to
gonna be
do...
influence is the role. I'm
yes,
sorry.
There we go.
All I do is click the description, like, hey everyone, just so you're aware.
Mm-hmm. And you're casting it at level 5?
Yeah.
Okay, so you'll have to be a 20.
That's just wanted everyone to know also what happens.
Oh, no, perfect, details. Perfect.
Oh,
just delay the inevitable. So Chance is like, don't worry, don't worry. I'm great with animals. And he sort of holds out his hand. He's like, come on. Come on, dog. I am your master now. I am your master.
The dog is not even kind of fazed by what you're saying. It continues to make this weird, deep, rumbling, cracking sound, almost like wood splitting and moving towards you. Now its pace increased. Now its eyes fixated on you and only you. Brom?
Yeah, I should have glanced at Chance, and I say, ah, Chance, at it again. I think the only language these creatures understand is a blade, and then I hack down at the creature as it approaches.
Okay.
So, this is a might attack? Is that what happens? Mm-hmm. I roll my might?
It should actually, there should be an attack action right underneath. Oh, it wasn't added. Yeah, I would roll your might.
Okay, so here's my might. No advantage or disadvantage dice. Neither advantage nor disadvantage. Mm-hmm. So hit. I got an 18.
18, that definitely hits.
Nice.
So as you bring down your sword on this wooden creature, you hear a loud crack. And you get it right on the haunch. And you see the wood sort of split there. And its pace is now, like, you give the creature pause. So as you rush forward and hit it, as it's approaching, it like moves back a little bit, or is actually not even moved back, it's pushed back with like this sort of crumpling force, and it yet lets out this weird sort of like the sound of the wind moving through the trees, almost like a sigh.
No.
And you know you've heard it.
How much damage do I do? Is it the amount that I beat the target number by is the amount of damage that I deal?
Yes.
Cool. And do I get to know that as a player, or is that hidden from me?
I usually hide it.
Okay, cool.
I think it's up to the GM, and I typically
hide it. Does it look seriously
injured?
I will
let you know when you inflict more than 10 damage, because at that point you can also inflict a bane of your choice. So.
Does it look seriously injured, or does it look like I've just chipped this creature?
No, you hurt it.
Okay.
Yeah, it's in pain. If it's capable of experiencing pain, it sort of crumples in on itself a little bit and gets shoved
aside. I bark to the rest of my friends. They can feel pain, and then I just wade forwards, my sword drawn high.
Mm-hmm. And you can actually attack again if you would like.
I absolutely would like. I advance on this creature as it cowers back from me, bringing this heavy slab of metal down on its neck.
Okay.
You got a 10.
Oh, unfortunately, that one does not connect. As you bring your sword down, you're thrown off as this other hound sort of circles around you, the one that is right next to it, and sort of tries to flank you. And that throws you off a little bit, and you do hit it, but you definitely don't hit it on the neck. Instead, your axe comes down and just kind of hits him on his other flank and kind of bounces off, but it does do a little bit more damage to it.
Oh, nice.
And with that, the second hound makes its attack, and it is going to bite at your leg. It's going to leap forward. Okay, and what is your toughness?
Toughness of 16, and if they're dealing slashing or finesse damage.
Yes, which is what I would consider this to be, finesse. So it, in fact, actually doesn't strike you at all. As it reaches in to sort of get you, its teeth kind of get stuck on the rough outer armor of your leg, and it's kind of just stuck there, confused, not quite sure why nothing is working.
I think I probably thrust my body into some sort of strange silhouette that's very obviously in some arcane kata that I've learned to defend myself.
Perfect. And then Jonathan.
Return fire. We got a hound going in a bit of one-on-one combat with me, right? So I'm ready to slash back once it comes in for its second approach. Is that a might or is that an agility?
For what?
To attack the wolf that just attacked me.
It would be depending on which weapon you're using.
Short sword.
I believe that's an agility weapon.
Okay.
I think you do have a might weapon, but I'm not sure. I think
I've got the hammer, which I imagine is.
Yeah, I think the hammer is a might weapon, and you chose a short sword back at town. Yep.
Yep.
So agility.
Okay. Ooh. Mm-hmm. Not bad.
So that does strike, and which hound do you strike?
So there was the one that quickly launched himself at me right away, right after Giles.
Is it that one that you get?
Yeah.
Okay. So as it like strikes you and continues its sort of trajectory back around to circle around for another blow, you do manage to strike it with your sword and hit it in its rear leg. And you notice it doesn't take, he doesn't get too affected by this damage, but he is a little bit slowed down. You see a chunk of bark go flying off.
Okay.
And then we move back up to Giles.
Excellent. Is my blunderbuss reloaded, or do I have to take a round to reload?
Yes, it's reloaded. It's ready to go.
Excellent. All right. I'm going to track one of these creatures that are either circling us or taking a bite of fair Jonathan and pop another shot in it.
Okay. Are you targeting the one that's off to the side or the two that are in front of you? Because you can target both of them, you just have a minus one advantage on each additional target.
Yeah, since it's a spreading weapon, it goes like that, I'll try to get two for one.
Okay, yeah.
Since it's a pretty sweet...
So just take a negative one when you roll it.
I'll take it. One advantage or disadvantage. I have disadvantage and go. Badoo! Not bad.
So that connects 17. With both of them. You hear this large exploding sound. You just see random bits of metal fly everywhere.
It's just, it cartoonily like lifts itself up over the top of my head.
Thankfully, Brom's armor protects him from the blunt of the blast, but the two hounds are not as lucky, and they each take They each not only are knocked back by the force of this blow, but they each get like just chunks of random bits of wood are now blasted off of them, and they both look dazed. So one of the hounds will actually skip his turn, this turn, since that is sort of Giles' weapon's little shtick, is that
stunning.
It's quite disorienting.
I snarl and I bark back at Giles. Ah, watch where you're pointing that thing.
Well, I would assume that he was right in front of me because I was hiding behind him, right?
Yes, yeah.
I wasn't going to shoot it at his back, but yeah, we'll play that game.
It could have hit him.
Yeah.
I do apologize, but you best move away for the next one. Giles is feeling pretty useful right now.
And with that is Chance.
I love that you're doing that, Mike.
I'm packing another wad. Sorry, keep going.
Of course. And Chance, what do you do?
Chance looks at the situation and looks back at old Chippy and goes, I've got this. And holds out his hand one more time and rolls for the chance to charm this beast.
I really want you to have it.
I want it too. But I want. All right.
Is it one of? It's not one of the ones that we knocked down. The right. It's the one that's circling him.
It's old Chippy. He's slowly approaching me, and he's got half his face.
It's the most damaged hound of all of them.
Old yeah, Chippy. My influence should be. I should be able to control this hound. Here we go.
Oh, a 24. The hound is hurting, it's limping, it's just had taken two severe blows from a giant greatsword and two blasts to the face from a blunderbuss. And all of a sudden, it sees your glowing angelic face warmly reaching out to it. And out of nowhere, you see this hound, like, well, not out of nowhere, but suddenly this hound's demeanor changes and it kind of makes a weird, like, whimpering, like, tree cracking type of noise and, like, saunters towards you.
I'm sorry, I'm trying to interpret what the sound is.
I turn to the others and just shout, I did it!
Well, good, now that you have a little friend, why don't you stick it on his bodies? Getting very annoying.
I will add Chippy to the initiative track.
Yes. Yeah, I'll just say Chance shouts, get them.
So Chippy's going to go last. Or, well, actually, he's already on the initiative track. I'll have him take his normal turn, which is actually coincidentally after yours anyway. Who do you want Chippy to sick?
What is the one currently threatening our team the most?
Well, there is one that is kind of latched onto Brom's leg, but not doing really any harm. And there's another one that is circling around to make another attack at Jonathan.
Protect the others.
Yeah, I'm going to say Jonathan. Okay. Because, God, that guy's a mess.
So you're going to have Chippy.
You just have to keep bailing him out, man.
Every time.
How do you instruct Chippy?
I point at Jonathan, and I shout, "Don't worry, John. His bark's worse than his bite." And then I look down at the dog. And I'm like, "Well, that didn't make any sense." Get him! And I point off to the other dog.
Inspired by your super awesome pun, Chippy gets an advantage on his roll this time.
Because why not?
Jonathan just like, you can hear him groan audibly from the other side of the camp as you say that, while in the midst of combat.
So Chippy goes and immediately like bounds towards this other hound and crashes into its rear hind quarters and takes off a big chunk of the wood and takes it with him and then immediately bounds back and circles around with like a big chunk of like wood in his mouth, and he's like wagging his little wooden tail, and he brings it back to you. Very pleased with himself.
That's my boy.
That is brilliant.
And with that, it is Brom's turn.
Brom
Brom shouts over to Chance. He says, "Ha ha! It's just like the time with the flesh jellyfish, isn't it, old friend?" And I slash down at the one that's... Wait, so the one that I hit twice last time is still alive, yeah?
That is the one that Chance chose to charm.
Okay, right, yeah, all right, fine.
It's a half-dead skeleton puppy wooden thing.
So flesh jellyfish, terrible, terrible tale. I'll tell you sometime later, and I hack
terrible
down.
Terrible and dirty.
I hack down at the creature attached to my leg. So let's see, that's a might roll.
Mm-hmm. We're never going to make it to this cave.
I got a 9.
As you strike down, you still manage to hit the creature, but it is at an awkward angle since it is latched onto your leg. So you kind of just deal a glancing blow to its tail and its hindquarters, and it's not really too fazed by this.
Now, you said I could make 2 attacks around.
Yes.
And I'm taking my 2nd attack.
Go for it.
Boom, nailed it.
All right, well, that with a 24, you definitely hit. And the 2nd time, re-getting your bearings and reassessing the situation, you swing again, and this time you slice in a downward motion and get it up into the ribs, and you just see wood like go everywhere, and the sound, you smell like chlorophyll or the smell of cut grass as you get up and scoop up into the innards of this creature, and you know that it is in its death throes because of the sound it lets out and how it immediately slackens its grip on your leg. And with that, it is the 2nd wolf's turn. It is still latched onto your leg, and it's going to attempt... Well, actually, this one was stunned by the blunderbuss, so never mind.
Man.
And with that, it is Jonathan's turn.
Jonathan yells over to Chance. "It's probably the most impressive thing you've done yet!" Runs right at the wolf, is going to attempt to help out Chippy and finish off the last one here.
Okay.
We're dicks to each other.
You could be nicer for sure.
Yeah. All right.
Ooh.
Oh.
So as you run forward and attempt to, take a strike at this thing, you actually trip and you miss. You don't fall down, but you just stumble and you miss completely. But then you hear this loud crack. Just as loud as, you know, it almost, you know, makes you do that type of thing. And over your shoulder, you see General Lee standing, not, you know, she's almost used your shoulder after stumbling as a little mount for her gun. And point blank, she takes a shot at this thing, and its
Furious
head explodes, and you have splinters and bits of wood and chip flying everywhere. I'm gonna have you make an evasion roll to see if you dodge or manage to get out of
splinters in your face.
Okay, so you manage to get your arm up in time, and your arm takes, or your forearm takes the brunt of sort of this like shower of sharp, tiny wooden shrapnel, and that beast is officially dead. And Lee just picks her sniper rifle back up and, you know, kind of twirls it and puts it back on her back and takes out her combat knife and, you know, starts to approach the one that is attached to Brom's leg. And with that is Giles' turn.
John mutters, "Jesus Christ!" under his breath.
So there's one left at this point, and is he still engaged now that Chippy and his buddy has been blown up?
He is. I think he likes me. He's got nothing to lose at this point.
All right. Well, I'm going to level my blunderbuss right at him, and feel pretty good about things. Not a Chippy. Don't worry. Don't worry.
Okay, so technically, there's 2 left.
Yeah, not an old Chippy, but
I'm more concerned about a blunderbuss being leveled at my friend's feet. But
I didn't need that leg.
Yeah.
Is it still attached to? Is it still attached to?
No, its grip. Its grip. It was broken when it took that huge like shot to the ribs, but okay. It is still in his vicinity. It was knocked back a little bit, but it's still there.
I'll get Morgan's on top. I'll get on top of it a little bit. Neither.
22.
Okay, that definitely hits. Unfortunately, what is your evasion rating?
For Brom? Me?
No, for Brom.
11.
11. Okay, so it does hit you. But I'm going to say that because the creature is in front of you, you only get hit by a small amount of this flying shrapnel.
But is this shrapnel a finesse attack?
Yes.
Then it's evasion of 14.
In that case, you would take a lot less from it. So with given the fact that the silhouette of this creature is in front of you and you've invoked that boon, you only take 3 damage from the flying shrapnel, and it kind of just like, it's stuff that's glanced off of the creature, and that buckshot has kind of like hit you in your leg armor, and the animal in front of you, whatever little life it had in it, leaves it as this buckshot hits it in the back, and just like you see bits of green and wood fly everywhere, and it just collapses on the ground, almost like a pile of sticks, and it is vanquished.
I am so sorry, Brom. I have a bit of an itchy trigger finger, and I was worried for you.
Good shot. I slide my sword into my scabbard on my back.
Chance goes over and helps Jonathan up, and he's like, that's the most impressive thing you've done so far.
Jonathan can't say anything. He's just shaking his head. He's still holding his ear. He can't fucking hear anything either.
I'd like to go in and investigate the creatures because I'm fascinated by their innards.
Mm-hmm. Go for it.
Yeah. Girl, let's pull some logic for this, see if I can ascertain maybe some information that we can glean for attacking it later. Logic, it is really good. With a 39, it's really good.
So because you rolled a 39, generally joins you, and she kind of like touches these bundles of sticks and stuff with her foot. She looks a little bit confused, and she says to you, I could swear to you, I've surveyed the area while I was gone, and I didn't see any arbormancers or anything. It's really strange these creatures would come to life on their own. And you notice from looking at them that they're decidedly made from the sort of foliage that's around you. They're made out of the same kind of bark and wood and trees as the trees that are around you. So it is definitely strange that they've come to life of their own accord. And as you're both looking over the remains, generally pats you on the shoulder and kind of laughs and says, next time, why don't you just use fire? And you now learn that they take triple damage from fire attacks.
Oh, that would make sense. Mm-hmm. Well, it does seem to be local foliage, and even though there's no arbormancer about, let us keep our wits about us, and I bundle up the sticks and make a couple of torches out of them. Remains of the creatures. So
by this time, you know, twilight is sort of falling, it's getting darker. And with that, you know, Lee kind of gathers you all and she says, well, from what I saw, you guys can definitely handle yourselves in a fight. Well, some of you anyway. Whap, she kind of looks at Jonathan.
No.
The third woman to snub you. I feel bad.
Oh, Jonathan has never had his ego more crushed than this moment right now, but he'll stand there and take it like a man.
Can we double time it to get to the opening of the cave a little bit before it gets
definitely to and generally okay. Actually advises you of that. She lets you all know, like, listen, while I was out there and about, I did find the entrance to the cave again. It's just on this cliff. We'll have to rappel down the side of it. Shouldn't be too difficult. We have some rope in our bags, and I'll lead you guys in. I surveyed the entrance while I was gone, and there doesn't seem to be anyone in the vicinity.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Yeah. It's a little bit depressing, since we were hoping to find some specimens to bring back to Dr. Javarik in the hopes of creating an antidote for this strange epidemic, but
is there a
boon that there's no strange creatures around here. I mean, other than the ones who just fought.
Helm, do you think that there's a chance that these creatures are nocturnal and will only be coming out as it begins to get darker?
I don't know, but I don't care to find out.
All right, let's get over there, and I'd say we just make camp close to the cave and potentially see if anything comes to investigate.
Okay. So as you head down, you know, the steep sort of cliffside, and General Lee sort of instructs you on how to get down there safely. You guys reach the bottom, and right here, like on the coast, there's a beautiful ocean on the beach. She leads you to the entrance of the cave that she had discovered earlier when she went to find Nanki. And she looks around at you and advises that you all come inside because she doesn't trust making camp out here at night, especially seeing how the bandits had met some kind of grisly end out here as well.
I think this is the time that I would like to invoke my observant quality, which lets me see a weird thing, including that kitty tail that's flipping up about. I'd like to see if there's anything odd or weird at this cave entrance, mm-hmm. in particular to make sure that Helm is being honest about our livelihood and she doesn't have any misgivings at the moment. Yeah. So
seems strange that we would camp inside the dangerous cave, right?
Yes, exactly. That's what my thoughts are as well. Mm. Thank you. Is that all right, Jasmine?
Yes, of course.
Okay. Then I would like to observe the outside of this cave, and particularly look at Captain Helm, and make sure that even though she is a trusted individual of Dr. Tavarek, I am, of course, a bit wary about mm-hmm. camping inside of this dark and potentially dangerous cave, especially making a fire inside. Seems like it could be, cause a lot of attention to us.
Okay. And, did you roll a 39?
No, that was my old role.
Oh,
observant,
okay.
Observant just gives me some information.
Oh, is that the one you automatically pass? Yes, that's your, feat, correct?
Yes, it's my feat.
Okay. What you notice is that, you know, she kind of shifts around. She's like, well, I guess I'll take your advice on it. I just don't like being out in the open like this.
I appreciate your concern, but why don't we find some place a bit more secluded that's still outside, and we might and yet still be able to observe the cavern entrance?
Mm-hmm. She looks around sort of wearily, and she says, "Well, I think we should definitely stay on the beach, you know, considering Absolutely. That those strange creatures came out of the forest."
Oh, well, fair enough. As long as they don't come out from the ocean. but they are fish people. Well, anyway, let's camp fish in the people. Rocks.
They seem more like the sort of creatures that would go into the water.
Well, that is a good point. Cave? Well, friends and comrades, are we safer in the cave or are we safer on the beach?
Chance is too busy playing with his newfound friend, Chippy! And doesn't care.
I'm just make a roll for it.
You found that Chippy actually has a very happy demeanor, and he's but his presence greatly upsets Lee, and she's kind of fingering her revolver and looking at Chippy kind of awkwardly because she doesn't trust these beasts.
Bronze, if we're trying to identify whether it's safer to camp in the open or camp in the cave, mm-hmm. can Brom just check around the area just inside the cave and just outside the cave to see if there are any tracks or scuffs
yeah,
or anything
definitely.
Inside or outside that would indicate which one is more dangerous?
Yeah, go for it. I would check.
All right, here we go.
Why are you doing 22. That? I think. Ooh, nice.
Whoa. Roll a 22. So, since you rolled a 22, you notice that just inside the cave, there's no new tracks. It actually looks like no one has been inside for quite some time. But outside the cave near the water, you do find strange finned tracks here and there, and you're not quite sure where they're going to or coming from.
Yeah. I shout back up toward the cave, and I say, "We sleep inside. There are strange creatures about."
Strange creatures about inside?
Outside.
Outside.
Though, if we're looking for a specimen, perhaps one of us should keep watch.
Excellent. I am willing to listen to the man with the big sword.
Jonathan has found a stick to try to get Chippy to play fetch, but then thought about it and realized that was kind of fucked up and tossed
Chippy
it away.
Chippy doesn't care and immediately grabs it out of your hand. Because Chippy's the dog, he doesn't know any better.
So do you guys decide to make camp just inside the mouth of the cave then?
That's where I would recommend.
Yeah, Chance offers to take the first watch.
Oh no, okay.
I guess that means Brom takes the second.
I'm going to suggest that I actually take the second, if I may. I'm a bit of a night owl.
Is like the shot just of our eyes cutting back and forth?
I'll take second.
Because, fine.
Good.
I'll take fourth.
Third and a knot of second more. And not a watch more. Okay, cool.
As you're making camp here in the mouth of the cave, you know, generally helps, you know, set up a fire and set up, you know, some sleeping cots and things like that. And as you're sitting there and getting ready, you know, you guys eat some bread that Tavarik has packed for you, and generally grills up some bacon, and she gives some to Chippy, but Chippy doesn't really eat it, so.
Poor Chippy.
Chippy.
Poor Chippy. I'm gonna assume Chance eats Chippy's portion of extra bacon.
Chance doesn't eat pork.
Oh.
Sorry.
Never mind.
What a weird thing.
It's a character choice, Scott.
It's gonna be really important later on, I promise. Oh, no.
Apparently Chance doesn't eat pork, so there's more bacon for everyone else.
I think Brom eats both Chance's and Chippy's. Extra.
Oh, Jonathan's gonna sneak in there for double help. Is he kidding me? All the way.
Flap.
And you know, the night goes relatively uneventfully. You do notice generally kind of like paces off deeper into the opening of the cave in a couple of different times, just to see what lurks beyond the edges. She's definitely very curious and very worried about the situation that you're all in. And with that, you know, you sort of camp for the night. And when you're suddenly awoken by Chance, who lets you know that General Lee at some point darted off into the caves, seeing as how she heard something strange coming from within him. Instead of trusting Chance, seeing as his was the first watch, because he was kind of just playing with his pet dog in the opening of the cave, she instead ignores him and she starts pacing, like, you know, quickly walking into the cave. Not running, but quickly walking into the cave.
This is not commonly accepted military strategy within Schlechtenberg.
Now we have to go into the dark cave and it's late, and why couldn't she just do this thing in the morning? Oh, well, best after her, I suppose.
I unsling my sword and I say, she couldn't wait until morning because going at night makes a cooler story. Starts walking into the cave.
Stories, stories. It's always about stories with these folks as I'm lighting a torch. Why can't it just be warm with tea and
poor
maps?
Giles.
And I'll light one of my torches and offer Jonathan one if he wants one.
Grabs right out of your hand.
Okay. Would you like me to light it first?
Nah, I'll take a dry one. Yeah, go ahead and light it.
Right. Yeah, light it too. We'll follow Bron into.
Well, Chance did see her sort of where she went off to while she was muttering about how he's a goddamn imbecile. And
you hired her. Oh no, you hired Brom, never mind.
I charmed a wood dog. Imbeciles don't do that.
Case in point, actually, I think.
So as you're walking pretty loudly, because you also have this like sort of puppy that's like making all these weird creaking and strange noises as he comes along, you find yourselves in an antechamber inside the cave, and it almost comes into a point at the front, and you notice that it branches off to the left and to the right. Which way do you go?
Is there any signs? Sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say that. Are there any like scents that we can smell down either way? Are there any
you
sights?
Can roll for it.
Air? Yeah, I'm going to perceive if there's any difference I can judge. 14.
So, as you stand here and look at the two different openings, in one you smell almost a vaguely moldy smell, It's a weird sort of plant-like smell that you haven't really smelled before. And in the other one, you don't really smell anything too ominous.
Can I sort of communicate to Chippy to... Maybe we can rely on his senses to figure out if there's something?
Chippy, you don't
speak human.
Chippy's
not very smart. You can try to, but I'm not sure. You can roll for it.
I would love to do that. But is it his roll, or what are we...
I'm going to have you roll for it, and I'm going to have you roll, let's see, I'm actually going to have you roll your influence, since it's your influence over him.
All right, great, let's do this thing.
Chippy Chippy, what you going to do, Mr. Chippy? 14.
So, Chippy, how do you communicate with Chippy?
I'm like, I get down sort of next to him. I'm like, Chippy, Chippy, what do you smell? What do you smell, Chippy? Is there something down there? Is there a treasure?
He's just getting excited. And he's like bopping up and down, and he's just getting like really excited. And he like does that thing that dogs do where he like rocks and he like looks back like, you're coming? And he's like. And he just keeps doing
just
that.
Rather, it's his nap time. You don't get him riled up.
Chance pops up and he just looks at the, he looks at Chip and he looks at everyone else and he's just like, I say we follow the wood dog.
Does the wood dog seem like he's going in the direction of the moldy plant smell?
Yes.
Yeah, Brom, like everybody else runs on ahead and Brom says, wait, there's a moldy plant smell.
Well, it would appear maybe we found our villagers then.
Maybe.
Maybe. Well, mold could be anything. It could be algae. I mean, these are caves, and they are moist. They are moist, right?
A bit, yes, yes. Definitely. Okay. There's some sea air that wafts through.
Yes, well.
And as you enter the second chamber, you see, like, a thin layer of almost slime or sludge on the slick cave floor and on every surface. And you notice that this is almost, at one point... maybe was an ancient, like an ancient maybe storage chamber of some kind. It's empty now, but there's just shelves and different like jars and empty and broken pots and stuff. And they all have like this weird slick green film on just about everything here. Do you continue through? Do you stop and look around?
I would like to invoke some knowledge to see if I can glean some importance about this algae. Mm-hmm. About. I invoke some learning to see if I am learned about this particular lichen of sorts.
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's see. What you gonna do with that lichen? Apologies, I hit the thing. Let's see. Submit. Well, not too bad. Not great. We're just looking at a 12.
So you don't, while you're investigating the algae, you don't really notice anything that you would know of regarding where it's from or why it's here. What you do notice is a few footsteps inside of the algae. So you do know for certain that General Lee probably went this way.
She went this way, great. Well, seems our general has decided to come through this tunnel. Shall we?
I'd like to re-up my resistance, because I assume that we slept just a little bit, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to just make a roll for that really quick.
Go for it.
Mm-hmm. So I need a 16 in order to get it?
Yes. I think that was the number.
So do I just, like, keep trying?
Yeah, I think you can reattempt it, but I think you have to wait a couple minutes, and then you can reattempt it.
Okay, next room. I'm gonna try again.
So as you pass through, you enter into a new chamber, and as you're walking through a sort of doorway outside of this like slimy room, you feel a hand on this is more for Brom. Brom feels a hand on his chest as General Lee. She looks up at him. She goes, "Shh." And
I whisper to her. I whisper, "Speak."
And she points. And off in the distance, on an altar, you see a onyx skull that is almost like dripping in this weird, almost oil-looking substance. It's a black ooze that is drifting off of this strange relic.
Ooh.
And around it, you see all of these creatures that are fish-like. They're crouched, and they have fins for hands, and they're speaking in a weird tongue, almost towards this strange object, this relic. And it's almost like a relay, Cthulhu, Futun. And it's very like Ulular. It's like a strange, like almost like a blubbing, glub, glub, glub sound. Mm-hmm. Not anything that you can really understand or make out.
And, we had to find some deep ones.
About, you know, some speak of like a mother is, you know, like what you can hear. And, you know, Lee is sitting there almost petrified watching what is happening.
Yeah.
Terrified of what is about to happen.
Is she affected by something that's like magically impacting her, or is she just cowed by the sight that she's looking at?
She is questioning her sanity because she's never seen or heard anything like this in her whole life.
My question is, I have a restoration that can dispel the effects of
she's not pain. Active. No. She's in her right mind. She just can't believe that this is what she's seeing.
Yeah, okay.
So yeah. She slowly gestures for you to enter into the chamber behind her, and you're behind almost like these series of like weird walls that almost have engravings on them, and they're in concentric circles, but there's holes between them, if that makes sense, like little cutouts, and you're peering over them and you're seeing this ritual happen, and she ducks down behind it. And
how close is the closest one?
Maybe I want to say 15 feet.
Okay. Where are my allies?
They're right behind you. She's gestured them in behind you, and all standing.
We're all here.
Behind this strange engraved, like concentric circular sort of structure. And you're hiding behind it, and she's just like because luckily you haven't alerted them, because she was really good at ushering you in quietly.
Yeah, not yet anyway. Where did we put the torches?
You still
have
them.
Are they like back? Oh, so this room is lit then. It's not pitched.
Yes, that's why you can see what's happening.
Yeah, I gesture to
snuff the torches.
No, actually, I gesture to you, Giles, to hand me your torch. And how many torches do we have lit? Is it just
two?
We have two, but I have an extra one.
Yeah,
Jonathan's got the other, I believe.
I gesture to hand me both of the torches, and then I say, I whisper to the three of you. I say, you three probably want to stay down for this.
You do know that those are the villages of Woe's Herald, right?
And that's the artifact, yes?
I would assume, but you're not thinking of hurting the villages, are you?
Hurting? Chance, you remember the situation with the gear monsters from the clockwork dimension? Just like that. It's called a diversion.
And then Jeremy immediately sees what's about to happen. And in her worry and in her panic, she immediately pulls her knife out of her boot and just tackles you. And that moment, the whole room is filled with a blinding darkness. Something like a darkness so thick you cannot peer through it.
And our torches do nothing.
Huh?
And our torches do nothing.
Your torches do nothing. And you hear Chance sort of cackle, and you hear footsteps around you, and it goes quiet.
So I would like to immediately invoke a restoration on myself.
Mm-hmm.
Can I do that?
Yeah, you can.
Yeah, okay, cool. Let's see, so I'm gonna try this at level 4, which means I need to score an 18 or higher, right?
Okay. I'm excited if you can get vision. Oh!
Nope. Not good enough.
You can't peer through this thickening blackness, this thick, impenetrable darkness. But Jonathan.
Yes.
You seem to remember that this is not very different from the darkness that a certain one of your party members may have cast back at a Valorian camp to distract some guards.
Certainly, yes.
We're the distraction.
This clicks in my head as I'm attempting to navigate my way through this unnavigable darkness, and clicks, and I shout, Chance!
And there's this commotion as you hear these strange creatures going and like moving through and around you, and all of a sudden the darkness is like dispelled. The relic is gone. Chance is nowhere to be seen. Lee has her knee on Brom's chest, and you are surrounded. These creatures have now taken note of your presence because of all the commotion, and they're moving towards you. And in that moment, Lee, in her anger, is like, I knew it was an ambush, and she slices Brom's throat. Sending up a spray of blood everywhere, and she immediately readies herself and stands next to Jonathan and Giles and says, we're in for something now.
Oh my.
And well, that is where we end.
Damage, Chance!
Today's episode.
To add insult to injury, some of your sketches are gone too.
No! Why would you do that? That's just like rubbing salt in the wounds. Yeah, Jesse Cox, I will get you. I don't know when I will get you, but I will get you.
Mm-hmm. And he abandoned Brom, which he didn't technically have to, but
you know who I didn't abandon? Chippy is gone.
Yes, Chippy's with you.
As he's dying, Brom tries to like angle the spray of blood so it gets in her eyes a little bit.
Oh, great. Well, looks like we essentially are in the midst of this giant deep one fest for our next game.
Look, okay. On the bright side,
if you're lucky,
you
won't have to deal with Mother Hydra. So.
That's true. That one that I clearly can wield because
yeah, exactly.
I'm so brawny. So, you know, I can barely hold my blunderbust.
You guys are going to be in a sticky situation, but hopefully next week you will have some less douchey team members to help you get through it.
Unlikely.
Yeah, you guys, that Mercer's gonna be on, right?
I've met Mercer, so
and for the record, now that this whole thing is over and I can spoil it, the fake tracks, Chance was creating those the whole time and he arranged it with the GM ahead of time. So every time you saw a fake track or an apparition, he was making you guys hallucinate the entire time. That wasn't me, that was him.
Good job.
Yeah, I've been after this thing for a while, guys. Sorry.
All this feigning of ignorance, man.
Pretty.
I charmed a tree dog. You should have been like, oh no, this guy's got, you should have looked at my character sheet then and be like, wait a minute.
To be fair, I was warned against you. I was warned that you often play the characters that, especially in like the fact that you're here for a couple episodes, they like subterfuge everything. So I should have known Jesse Cox.
Steven, this was very surprising to me, Jesse.
Steven knows I am only good characters. I never betray people.
Exactly. You've always consistently in all of my shows played a really straightforward, on the up and up kind of guy.
Well, it's all fair because when Mercer played in my game, he literally destroyed all the universes. Like, he literally he chucked a universe-destroying grenade and destroyed the universe. So, as long as that doesn't happen.
I know, I keep a couple of those handy.
Well, we were playing Paranoia, to be fair. So. Yeah.
Hey guys, guess what? We have a sub winner. Commander Kieran just won a Steam key because every new subscriber on Fridays, we give away a Steam key. And I want to sincerely apologize to you guys for apparently our computer becoming possessed during the show today. That has never happened before. And upon Googling, I could not find any other instance of text-to-speech randomly turning on. So... apologies.
I blame Cthulhu.
I blame Cthulhu as well.
You should have known. You should have known what you were getting into. The signs were there.
It must have been Jesse.
I may or may not have designed the dungeon in the shape of an elder sign.
You what? quick reminder to everybody, coming up next on the channel at 6 p.m. PST is the season 2 premiere of Death From Above, our custom space opera, battle tech, beat 'em up, 3D printed mechs, explosions, craziness. You should definitely tune in for that, and I'll let you guys get back to it.
Yeah.
Sweet.
First of all, Steven, Jesse, thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah.
This is fun. You guys were wonderful to have on board, and I liked your combo of I am a stoic, solemn douchebag, and I am a chipper, happy douchebag. You guys need to have like a buddy cop comedy.
Good douchebag synergy here. Yeah,
a lot of pop collars and backwards hats.
Chugging beers from like keg stands.
Yeah, I hold your legs up.
Absolutely.
Let's go around and just give everybody one quick last who you are. Bear, take it away.
Hello, I am BaerTaffy, B-A-E-R-Taffy on Twitch, Twitter, and YouTube. I also host a podcast called Roundtable. That's the name of it. Fridays, 12 o'clock Pacific on twitch.tv/roundtablepodcast.
Sweet. Ivan?
I am Ivan Van Norman. I am Hydra_Lord on Twitter, and I play a lot of board games and role-playing games on the Geek and Sundry channel, but I also play stuff on my personal Twitch channel as well.
Wonderful. Jesse?
Hi, everyone. I have not near as good synergy as BaerTaffy. I am all sorts of different names and all sorts of different things. I will simply say that I pride myself on ruining everything on Geek and Sundry, and I also enjoy coming on to other people's RPG shows and playing asshole characters.
Hey,
and,
we loved having you.
Yeah, it's super fun. So.
It was you? All along. All the fucking long. God damn it.
Yeah, I'm the one who, I ruined everything for everyone else, so I'm very happy to continue that tradition.
And Steven?
Hi, I'm Steven, Silent0siris, the O is a zero, everywhere, Twitch, Twitter, YouTube. I haven't been streaming too much recently because I've been relaxing a whole bunch, but every Saturday morning at 10:30 a.m. Eastern Time, I'm running a role-playing game called King Arthur Pendragon. So if you want to watch some, come watch some cool game designers play Knights in the Time of King Arthur. You should check that out in exactly 14 hours from now on my channel.
Awesome. And I am that Bronze Girl, your GM. First of all, I thank all these wonderful people for playing my weird ass campaign and putting up with my fucking weirdness. I appreciate you all. I know I'm pretty new to DMing, so I'm happy that y'all are here. But yeah, you can find me on Twitter at BronzeGirlGames. I'm pretty sure that's underneath my name. And you can find me on Twitch at thatbronzegirl.com. This week's actually my partner spotlight, so I'm going to be on the front page successfully lowering the overall classiness of Twitch. One cuss word and a salty remark at a time. So, the front page is about to get a whole lot bronzer.
Bronzer! Look at that bronze! What are you going to be doing when you're on the front page?
I'm a variety caster. I'm going to be playing all kinds of stuff.
Warcraft. All Warcraft all the time.
Yes.
All the time.
And, I don't know, RuneScape.
Wow.
All right, well, cool. Well, if you end up playing Civilization 6, invite, because that's what I'm...
Dude, I play Civ. You play Civ?
I'm so hot on it right now.
Have you checked out the new Total War DLC with the Wood Elves? You get in on Total War, my man?
No.
Why are we all being these characters all of a sudden? I don't understand. What's going on here?
No, I don't do... I haven't done the Total Rome yet, but I've just been... because I've been doing Civ since, like, Civ 2.
Oh.
You know, dating myself. But it's... I love it. And I have an ongoing... I had an ongoing stream until I conquered the world, but now I have to do another one in which I do not do a religious victory, because that's the easiest thing to do.
That is the easiest
thing. In Civ 6.
Total Annihilation's way harder.
Total Annihilation is the hardest. Mm-hmm. So, and the science is particularly harder in Civ 6 than
I can agree with that.
You know.
Well,
but
thank you guys so much for joining me. You're a lovely bunch of people, and I enjoyed this episode. Hopefully, you enjoyed it as much as I did. Viewers, stay tuned for Death from Above. Episode 2 is starting soon. I stumbled across my words there, so let's just take it away, QQ. Bye.